That's loud. Now, I'm going to get you all to do me a big favor. Can you come forward, everybody move up here? You need to be able to see the quilts, so it's silly to be in the back row. And also, I want to feel so lonesome and this one feels so fun. Thank you very much. I just like a couple of audience engagement while we're here, while we start, because it helps me know. So, why did you come? Somebody tell me why on a day like this, if you said, I can get out in the rain and the wind and turn up and hear this woman I've never heard of talk about something that sounds incredibly esoteric. Who wants something to be brave?
Well, I have heard of you.
You have heard of me? Okay. I'm back, yes. So it's like old diplomats are like something you can't get rid of. That's true. That's true. Sorry.
I work here and I'm just like,
I'm going to
work my balance and just start going to more things on different
things. Fabulous. Good for you. I when I was at Curtin, I was there for about a year and that suddenly dawned on me. I was doing nothing to benefit from the fact that I worked on a university campus. So good for you. One more? Oh, good. Three more. Quick.
Love art.
Fabulous. Okay, it sounds like you're from my part of the world.
Colorado.
Okay, good.
Yeah. I thought to myself, there's got to be a better way to express free speech and art together to make a real impact.
Good. Fabulous. And somebody with you.
The leadership aspect of the faculty and people who bring the leadership.
Fabulous. Okay, well, I have to admit, you haven't made my job any easier because I just went all over the place, which is great. I'm so excited and honored to be here. And when we, I'll be honest, I have somebody on my staff who used to work for Country Arts WA. And so when I got the, I ran into Ted somewhere in the world wandering around, and he said, hey, would you do this? And I said, of course, I'll, you know, as when I was Consul General, I'll speak at the opening of an envelope, I'll turn over anything. And that's my job at Leadership Voice of Australia, is to do anything I can to get us to think about leadership and leading anywhere, leading at any level, leading everywhere. And so the more I can help in Western Australia inject conversations about how important authentic leaders and leadership is, and how we can support people within ourselves to exemplify authentic and courageous leadership, and how we can also support other people who are supporting courageous leadership or exhibiting courageous leadership. That's my job description, so how lucky am I? And I've got to say, I used to say I had the best job in the world representing the United States overseas. I don't say that, and I'm not actually sure I would miss being in that role right now. So sure, I would still say that if I were still in this role. So I think I was, it was a huge leap of faith to go from, I never worked in an organization that didn't have tens of thousands of people, and so to work dump into one that I have 11 staff was quite a scary thing, but I feel like right now I have the best job in the world and I'm very fortunate.
Sorry, we're having problems with the sound. Could we try speaking without the microphone?
Yes,
oh,
you don't need the microphone.
So I'm just going to go and strip and take this off.
Much better.
Yeah. It's a lot better for me. Good. Thank you, Donna, for taking action there. So here I am, and as I said, my colleague, when I had the invitation, I said, what can I speak about this? And I was doing it on the phone. And I said, okay, yeah, just write that up. Write that up and send it off to UWA, to the gallery. And when I wrote to Clarissa the other day, I said, what did I say I'd speak about? I have to admit, I got taken aback a bit. But I do want to talk to you about the visual arts and how there's similarities between the visual arts and leadership and how visual arts can be thought-provoking as far as leadership goes. I think there are a lot of similarities between art and leadership. And one of the things I get asked an awful lot is, what is leadership? Is it something you're born with? Is it something you can develop? And I'll bet that the people who work in this gallery and people who work in the art field in general, whether you're creators or curators or lecturers, also get asked, what is art? And how do we determine what art is? Who gets to decide? Who gets to say who's a great leader? Who gets to say who's a great artist? And one of the reasons I got to be friends with Ted Snell, the director of the House of Miss Mark Gallery, I think that's your title, right? Yeah. And other things even bigger, was because of a conversation we had when Ted was at Curtin, and I had come from the home of my driver's father. So when I was the U.S. Consul General because of security, because I had a full-time driver. And one of the things he'd said to me in the first couple of weeks I was there was, I have this invitation from my father-in-law, he'd love you to come see his paintings. And you know how you do when somebody offers you something. You say, yeah, that'd be lovely, but there was no fixed date. And the years went on. Suddenly it's about 6 months toward the end of my tour, left of my tour, and he said to me, Robin, I really hate to ask you, but it really would make my father-in-law's day if you'd come look at his paintings. And my mother-in-law died a few weeks ago, and it had just made me so happy. And this was a guy who never asked me for anything. So we drove up to this very, very modest bungalow in Wolfsbrook, I think, got out and walked up to the front door, opened the door, walked in. It was like walking into something in The Wizard of Oz. Every square inch was covered with paintings and multimedia and sound hooked up to paintings and just this amazing treasure trove. And I kind of felt like, you know, you've seen a dollhouse that somebody's put ages, you know, and just kept putting one more thing in the tiny little living room and one more thing on the wall. And there were paintings stacked up on the couches, three paintings deep. And this elderly man said, oh, how nice that you've come. And we spent the whole afternoon there. And I think it was that afternoon or the next day, I went to something at the Curtin Art Gallery and saw Ted, and said, Ted, who gets to decide what folk art is? When is something what my crazy father-in-law does, and when is it art? Who gets to make that call? Does the person have to be dead? And sometimes I think about that about leadership. Do we have to wait until we don't have the leader in our midst, until we've finished high school and haven't seen that teacher or that person in our class who stuck up for the little guy? We haven't seen them for 20 years before it occurs to us. That's art. That was leadership. So in this case, I think we were quite lucky in a way, because Ted and Mary the next day, or the next week. Actually, he sort of said, oh, yeah, I'll go look at it. He did exactly what I did. And I said, no, we're going next Wednesday. And so we met there, and Ted looked at the art, and there was, to make a very long, and I know bureaucratic and sometimes frustrating story short, there was an art exhibition of Stanhope Wells' works in this very gallery, maybe 5 or 6 years later. Mm-hmm. And it was also a great story for me that sometimes it takes time for art to percolate and be recognized, and sometimes it takes a whole team of people to bring that nugget to the world. And I think sometimes that's true about leadership as well. So that was kind of my thinking about how the visual arts and leadership fit together in my world. That idea of who gets to say, and that will always be debatable. One of the hardest things in my job right now is that I want everybody to like me. I want everybody to think I'm a great leader. We have 800 alumni. We have trained them through our leadership development programs to be very thoughtful about leadership, to be very thoughtful about owning your mistakes, about the idea of an imperfect leader. And boy, do they delight in letting me know that I'm an imperfect leader. And it's been tough. There's something about being the American Consul General and having 5 federal police bodyguards around you. Australian Federal Police, not your tax dollars at work, not mine, I might say. But that people aren't necessarily very honest with you to your face about how they think you're doing. They're happy to tell you what's good. And they might tell you what's bad about America, but they very rarely tell you what's bad about you. And in this current role, there's a lot of ownership by our alumni and our participants, as we want there to be. But it's been a real adjustment for me. And again, I think, what does that mean for an artist? It must be terrifying to have your art form display in the gallery for the first time. It must be terrifying to know that the critics are going to put something in the newspaper the next day. Even if you know that's your life's blood, you can't operate, you can't be an artist without someone else appreciating it. So I always wondered, unfortunately, Mr. Hopewell, by the time we actually, the gallery and the family got everything arranged, in a way I thought it was sad because he was quite senile, I would say, by that point. And the first thing he said to me, it happened the way life is serendipitous. I had just moved back to Perth, and the son-in-law knew that, and had sent me a note and said, you know, would you open the exhibition, which was great. But the first thing Mr. Hopewell said to me from his wheelchair was, come sit on my lap, young lady. And in a way, I thought, how lucky he is. He gets to be here. But you know what? I mean, he didn't give a damn what anybody said. How many arts are that? So, anyway, the other thing that made me think about who gets to say what art is, and actually prompted me to bring the things that are here before, is thinking about Marcel Duchamp and the whole ready-made movement, the idea of ready-made pieces, and putting day-to-day items like a snow shovel or a urinal in a museum and signing it and saying, is this now art? Because a recognized artist said, I put it in that installation. And again, I'm sure that those of you who work in the art world face that dilemma all the time. You have a huge responsibility in a way. You have a huge opportunity to define what is valuable for the rest of us. So I wanted to talk a little bit today about something I'm quite passionate about, which is American quilts. And there's a line in this little placard, actually, that Janet Ponsicourt wrote about it wasn't terribly expensive. Once it becomes known that you're purchasing art, auction houses start sending catalogs to you. And that's kind of what happened to me with quilts. So I started getting interested in quilts because I needed something to cover up my windows in embassy-provided housing because I was sick of the boring white, thin, threadbare curtains the embassy always gave. And quilts were big, and so I thought, well, that's going to cover up those French doors just perfectly. But funnily enough, once you're on those mailing lists, you get more and more brochures and auction catalogs, and the more you pay attention to something, the more expensive your tastes get, and the more serious you become about it. Until right now, I probably have about 25 antique American quilts from before the 1900s, one of them from 1776, which was quite amazing. And I think a lot about why, if someone wants to push my buttons on my staff and my family, they talk to me about the bedspreads. Oh, you're going to do that thing with the bedspreads again. So what is art and what's a bedspread? You know, what's a painting and what's some crazy old man's throwing away, keeping himself occupied as he took care of his wife who had Alzheimer's? And I think you have a huge responsibility, and I really honor this role for doing that for all of us, making those decisions. So, I think there's a lot of commonalities between art and quilting and quilts. So, art has an impact. I like to think that quilts have an impact in a way. And how amazing that I walked in and saw that we're looking at some of the, you know, I get to do this right next to the Carruthers Women's Art Collection. How, I love the serendipity of that. So what is museum quality in art? What is museum quality in quilts? And why does it matter? Well, for me as a collector of quilts, it matters for one thing. It's clear, price. So a few decades ago, the people who own Esprit, the clothing company, decided they were going to make Amish quilts the cornerstone of their art collection. And if you have a moment, go online and Google, they have amazing Amish quilts. But Amish quilts are really, really simple. Big blocks of color. are more valuable than any other quilts. Amish quilt prices, even for brand new ones, went through the roof. And so again, this question of who gets to say what is art? Who gets to say what is leadership? I joked about Trump's election, but we had a whole swath of America just say, that's leadership. And just because somebody like me doesn't understand it, doesn't get how you can say that, doesn't make it any less wrong. And I'm sure those of you who work in the art world, and even I am just a normal pedestrian person who likes to go to museums and galleries and looks at something and say, that's art. Sometimes I think we have to say that's leadership and just let it sit with us a little while. So this is part of what I usually use to talk about some leadership lessons in my own life. And if you'll indulge me, I'll go on with this for about 10 minutes because it really just gives me a chance to show you some great pieces of what I think of art. This piece is made from family members, my family members' clothing. And made from the time when these pieces were taken from the time of Papua New Guinea and Indonesia and Malaysia, to some degree India. And a lot of it is drawn from e-cut fabric from Indonesia. And there's an Indonesian village where I happened to run into someone. And anyway, for about 10 years, I supported them with money and they supported me with emotional satisfaction because I got to see my family's life turn into what I call the PowerPoint of my life. And so they put these pieces together for us. And absolutely talented people. There's also a couple of leadership lessons I learned. So my four leadership mantras are just say yes. Somebody asks you to do something, you don't quite know how you're going to do it. Just say yes, you'll figure it out. The second one is confidence, which kind of goes with the you will figure it out. The third one is empathy. First, for yourself. This took me a long time, and I'm still working on it. Some of you know me, I know my husband died of a brain tumor about 3 years ago. And it really took me a long time to be able to say, you know, I've got some dark spots in my life. Now, you don't have to spend every day saying, oh, other people have it so much worse. Sometimes you just need to empathize for yourself, because until you do that, you really will never be able to empathize with other people. If that's anything. And one of the other things that I learned that this book reminds me of is sometimes you're better off accepting a situation the way it is. There's a piece of fabric in this quilt. This is a shirt that my husband loved to wear. My shirt was bright, gaudy kind of thing. And, you know, I was a very senior American diplomat. I'm sorry, I had to turn up things and be taken seriously. And it used to drive me nuts that he would wear the shirt. And so one day I smuggled the shirt into the bag of clothes that went to the quilting village. And so the shirt was gone. I thought I'd save that. I thought I'd solve that problem. He went out and bought this. And worked. So my message from that little leadership lesson is sometimes you're better off accepting things the way they are and not thinking you need to make such a huge change in things. Thanks, Trey. So, another area I like to use quilts to think about leadership is something about, let's just test this over here. We're going to get much more precious if you quilt down this. Yes, people always ask me if I quilt myself. Well, this is the only quilt I ever made myself. Does it even look like a quilt? No. It used to be this size. I started piecing this. Everything's pieced by hand. All the sashings by hand. I started piecing these blocks when I was at university in Kansas. And I pieced them, and I carried the blocks from one country to another. And I was in my first posting in Mexico. The housekeeper helped me, and we sewed these on by hand, the sashing. And then I took it to Papua New Guinea, and I did a little bit more work on it in Papua New Guinea, and it still doesn't top. And it wasn't until I moved to Indonesia a few years later that I gave to that village, and they actually did everything hand-built it. And I wanted it to be so authentic. I wanted it to be perfect. So I used a wall batting, which normally if you buy a modern frame, those are, now we use Dacon battings. And so this wonderful, beautiful quilt, it looked gorgeous when it got done. I was so happy with it, so proud of it. It's the only quilt I ever made. And I was really proud to be able to say, I did that. There are some mistakes, of course, but I was still really happy with it. Anyway, a few years later, my husband and I, after he had the brain surgery, we moved to Singapore, and I left a lot of things in my daughter's apartment here. And my daughter had cats. You can see where the story's going. My daughter came home one day, the quilt had been on the bed, the cats had been on the bed, the cats had not been able to get to the litter box. So she decided that this smells, I'm going to wash it. And she did, in the washing machine. Anyway, she didn't tell me. I wouldn't have probably told my mother either. I came back to Perth, but I took the role at Curtin University, and happened to be going through a cupboard looking for something, and I found this. To this day, I get a stomachache. How am I? First of all, I don't think calmly. How am I going to react? So as not to upset my poor daughter. That was not really in my mind. And then I thought, just go for a walk. And so I did, and I came back, and I said, what happened? And she told me the story. And then I put it in the cupboard. And it wasn't until a few years later when I started thinking about quilts that I was, as a metaphor for life and leadership, that I was going through the cupboard and I found it. And I thought, why aren't we using that as a snuggly, cuddly thing when we watch TV? It's the perfect size. It's actually still kind of cool. People spend, I've got this little arty scarfy thing on that somebody spent a lot of time felting bits and pieces to put up here. That's all this is, it's a felted piece of art. And so, as I think for leadership and your life in general, sometimes it's just really important to stop and breathe and say, you know what, the situation probably isn't as I had in my mind. It isn't my past definition of good or what I'm aiming for. But it's pretty darn cool. I'm actually kind of proud of it. And when we can say that to ourselves, people, you know, resilience is the buzzword. I don't know what resilience is. Partly I think it's just saying, geez, that's not what I thought was gonna happen. Okay, what's next? I look back at very earlier experiences, you probably saw, I spoke Robin with an I, and I turned up to do my master's degree in England on scholarship. And I walked into the faculty was when we'd be studying, it was a bunch of men with beards. Pipes and very, very proper. And they looked, I said, hi, I'm Robin McClellan, I'm a new grad student. And they looked at me and they looked at me. And finally said, but you're a girl? Yep. I said, but you, Robin's with an I. I said, yep. To that day, up to that point, I didn't know this I, Y thing for Robin. We wouldn't have accepted you if we'd known you were a girl. I said it straight to my face. So I thought, wow, what do I say to that? And part of my brain was saying, you're just lucky they said it out loud, rather than just thinking it. So I said, well, where do I put my things? And we went on from there. But that took some resilience. And you know what? A week later, it didn't make a bit of difference. If I'd gotten upset and gotten into the drama, which I am prone to do, it would have been a totally different experience. So sometimes, I wish I could tell you when I saw the quilt, I said to my daughter, oh, that's lovely, you created a different type of art. Thank you. I'm not quite sure I did that. But anyway, that's that story about resilience. This one is what's called a whole cloth quilt. And for those of you in the back, at some point you really should look at it. It's amazing. So it has 22 stitches per inch, which is gold standard. And it is a whole cloth on each side. It's very simple. And if I think about leadership, one of the things I'm slowly learning as I get older, and as I sit in the back of the room in our leadership development programs, is you can't lead if you don't have that white, clear spot inside yourself. I mean, like a white light kind of clear spot inside yourself. And I think that's such a hard thing for us to make time for, to carve out in our lives. And it's such a hard thing to accept, because we tend to think, oh, I'll succeed if I just work harder, if I squeeze one more thing in, if I accept one more meeting, if I meet one more person. So to me, this is one of the biggest leadership challenges, as frankly, making this quilt is for the quilters who do it. How do you make that calm space in your core? Sometimes just is where creativity comes from, where certainty and belief in yourself comes from. And it's something that I struggle with, I have to admit, practically every day. So I always love to show this whole quilt quilt because of that. The other thing that the quilting, as you know, that we talked about the women's exhibition here, and art in general, is attribution. Who made these? Who gets credit for it? What happens? That's 150 years later, when people look at this, 150 years after it was made, what do we know about that artist? Was she called an artist? I'm pretty sure she was a she. I think we can probably assume that. Could be wrong. I'm not sure how the light's in here, but this tumbling blocks quilt, to me, is so magnificent. It's from the 1880s. It's obviously done before computer-assisted design, probably done mostly by hand. Very different, it's not quilted itself, it's called a quilt, but it's not actually quilted the way the blocks are made. Usually, quite often in an old tumbling blocks quilt, you'll see the newspaper or bits of paper still inside the squares, which again, I love that metaphor for art and life, that there's different layers of things that are valuable. The newspapers are fabulous to read if you'd be brave enough to pull them out, which I wouldn't be, but all these things. The other thing I love about this, and then getting back to resilience, is it's white lighter blocks and dark blocks. If you squint, can you see the 3D effect? Mm-hmm. The 3D effect is what makes the stumbling block quilt so special. Mm-hmm. But it wouldn't happen if there weren't the darker blocks. Mm-hmm. And maybe in a way, life is quite a bit like that. Life in our organizations is like that. When we just roll on and on and things go well and it's great and smiling and super to be here, after a while people come to take those light blocks for granted. I'll tell you, when I was Consul General in Perth, I was talking to my mom one day, and I always say Perth was the only assignment I ever had where you could drink the tap water. And that's true. It was also the only assignment I ever had where our relationship with the host country was not quite complicated. Mm-hmm. And my mom said, how are you loving your job? I said, I love my job in Perth, but oh my gosh, getting along with the embassy is a nightmare. And she said, why? I said, well, I've just made a decision. I am never taking another posting where the relationship with our host country is simple. Because we need, as individuals, as humans, we apparently need X amount of strife in our life. So if we don't get it with the external relationship, we'll create it internally. Sometimes I think of this kind of quilt and I see those dark blocks and I think, wait a minute, am I intentionally creating a dark block in my life? Stop and look at it. But sometimes those dark blocks just happen. That's all of us have something in our lives we have to deal with or have had to deal with. And if I stop and remind myself that it's easier sometimes to see the whole picture because of that, I think that works towards resilience quite a bit. Finally, the other thing I want to think about art creating communities and building bridges between people. And I loved it when you raised your hand and said, I come to whatever's free or fun on LinkedIn or what's it called? Meetup and Eventbrite. We have sometimes people come into our leadership development experiences and say, I just saw something free and I decided to go to it. They are usually some of the best people, the best contributors to the experience. I also love the idea that, you know, quilting brings people together completely different. Mm-hmm. Completely different. And So this idea of art is building communities and reaching, building bridges across groups, and quilting does that as well. Also, I think there's a similar challenge in how we measure impact. So one of the things of leadership development we struggle with is that in order for us to pay me and other people and our bills, we need donations, we need people to pay their participant fees, all different sorts of funding. And now more and more donors are saying, well, what's the impact? What can you prove? And I would guess that the gallery struggles with this very same thing. Ted, tell me how the art program brings in more money for the university. So much what we contribute is ripples. Ripples through building a community. Ripples through inspiring people to think differently about something, and then they go on and create something fabulous in another sphere of the community. But we never even see it. We never see it. I've been so lucky, a couple of things in art. I told you about Stan Hopewell. In a normal diplomatic career, I would have never known that this crazy guy, who was my driver's father-in-law, was now a celebrated artist with an opening and a gallery catalog, et cetera, et cetera. I also happened to be at Curtin. I came back, when I moved back to Curtin, I first worked at Curtin University, and I was signing, doing my, you know, onboard induction paperwork, and I knocked some papers on the floor, and there were little cards like this, and I picked it up, and I recognized the painting on the front. To make a long story short, they were the Kerala paintings from the artists from the Stalin generation, the children who'd been in a camp down near Kitani. And when I was Consul General, the Perth International Arts Festival was bringing out the paintings that had been found totally by chance by an Australian artist historian or art expert who'd been visiting a university in the United States, Colgate University, and one of the people who works there said, oh, we have something from Australia in that box up on the top shelf. And they brought it down and there were these paintings that everyone thought had disappeared. They'd gone into the woman who, quote-unquote, discovered these children doing great painting, and she had bought them. The government closed down the settlement because, stopped the art program because it was being shining too much light on what was going on. And long story short, somehow this guy was probably one of five people in the world who wouldn't know what those paintings were. He saw them, he came back, the arts festival decided to bring them out for the festival. Of course, these things that have been stuck in a dusty box in a storeroom suddenly needed to be insured for millions and millions of dollars to be shipped out here. And so the art festival came to me at the consulate and said, can you help us? Because we don't have the money for the insurance that Colgate University is asking us to get. So we did some magic with the diplomatic pouch. Don't ask questions you might not want to know the answers to. And we got some of the paintings here and they were exhibited. And I happened to mention to some of the people from Colgate who were visiting, you know, you're just going to take these back and they're going to go back into a shelf, on a shelf in storeroom. Here, that actually makes some difference. Why don't you think about it? And it was sort of a throwaway comment, and I'm sure many other people made similar comments. And I happened to pick up these things off the floor when I was signing up for Curtin, to work at Curtin, and the opening of the transfer of those paintings was that week. I get response even telling the story. Mm-hmm. And so I feel very fortunate in my life, coming back to Port, that I get to see some of these ripples. But in all of our lives, there's so many of them. And the impact and the challenge of telling the story so that we get our communities to continue to support us is a real challenge, but a really important question for us as citizens and taxpayers to think about when we start complaining about why does the government spend some money and can't they cut this and can't they cut that. It's cutting really important things when we cut the arts. Finally, the other thing I would just like to leave with you is, so I think for me, one of the things I love about Leadership Western Australia is I get to say, because all of our programs are designed to be roughly equal representation from the not-for-profit sector, the corporate sector, and the government sector. And hopefully we make leaders better in all of those sectors. That's good. No, it's stitched. That's fine.
Okay.
I think for most of us, life comes together a little bit more like this. We hope it looks that beautiful. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes it seems like, oh, I'm down in the details of this embroidery on that patch. I can't see where this is going to fit. So a crazy quilt, this is something that in the 1880s, somebody shows you a crazy quilt and says it's from 1850, you can look at them very knowledgeably and say you're wrong. This actually was a craze in the 1870s and 1880s. Not surprisingly, it's very hard to collect any quilts from before the 1860s or 1864 because of the American Civil War. So what happens in war? What do you do with any bits of fabric lying around? And no matter how beautiful that quilt was, it probably got burned, ripped up, and just turned into something else. So I'm very fortunate that I have a few from before then, but most of the ones I have are from the 1880s, 70s, and 80s. This has the blue ribbons of the Muscatine Iowa County Fair in 1885. Crazy quilts were made, you can see also in these sort of books. Sometimes you'll see them and you can tell that different women made different blocks and then they were joined together. This one is, I'm guessing, probably the same maker throughout because of the length of the stitches and the quality of the visual. But you're welcome to come up and have a look when we finish. I think it's just a magical representation of life. And whatever point that we are or we get to in life, if we can kind of look back and say, my life was really crazy, but wow, created that. And I'm incredibly honored that it's being shown in front of Janet Holmes Court's portrait, because I think that Janet would be one of the first people to recognize and kind of embody that how you make a contribution to society is through lots of different things that you can add. And so with that, I'll quit talking. Happy to encourage you to talk, ask, answer questions, or just hear what you think.